Sermon text this morning will be from Book of Hebrews, chapter 8, verses 1 through 7. Now, the point in what we are saying is this. We ask of the high priest, who is seated at the right hand of the throne of majesty in heaven, a minister in the holy place, the true tent that the Lord set up, not man. For every high priest is appointed to offer gifts and sacrifices, thus it is necessary for this priest also to have something to offer. Now, if he were on the earth, he would not be a priest at all, since there are priests who offer gifts according to the law. They serve a copy and a shadow of the heavenly things. For when Moses was about to erect the tent, he was instructed by God, saying, "See that you make it according to the pattern that is shown to you on the mountain." But as it is, Christ has obtained a ministry that is much more excellent than the old, as the covenant he mediates is better, since it is enacted on better promises. For if that first covenant had been faultless, there would be no occasion to look for a second. This is the word of the Lord. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, now as we come to consider your scriptures, we would ask that the words of my mouth and the meditation of all of our hearts would be found pleasing and acceptable in your sight. Lord, we ask in the name of Jesus Christ, who is our Lord, our Rock, our Redeemer, and nearest kinsman. Amen.
Amen.
And welcome to being seated. Every single week in our worship service, you hear the words that Jesus told his disciples in the Last Supper. This is the blood of my covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. In the Luke's Gospel, Jesus very specifically says that it is a cup of the new covenant in Christ's blood. Whatever these words mean about what Jesus is doing in the Last Supper and what we are doing in the Lord's Supper, we'll talk about that in a few weeks. One thing that is clear, Jesus says that he is bringing the new covenant. Now, one sad truth is that this truth, the truth that Jesus brings the new covenant, is at the center of so much debate and so much division in the Protestant church. Disagreement in how the new covenant relates to what came before it, disagreement as to who is included in this covenant, how this covenant relates to our election and our salvation, all of these are questions that have led into division for the church. Different answers to these questions is historically why Baptists and Presbyterians and Lutherans have all splintered into their own churches. And we won't answer all these questions today. We'll touch on some of them in the upcoming weeks. But what I want to do this morning is look at the heart of the new covenant, to look at the center of the new covenant, and see what we find there. And I think what we find when we look at the very heart, the very core, the very center of the new covenant is none other than our Lord Jesus Christ. He is the fulfillment of all the promises that are made in the old covenant, and Jesus and his work is the climax of the story that God is telling. But first, I want to begin our last few weeks. Why are we talking about covenant? Well, because you can't read your Bible very far. If you begin in the book of Genesis, you get about 9 chapters before you come across this word. And you very soon begin to understand that this concept, this idea of covenant, is center and it is part and partial to all of Scripture. We as a church believe that the idea of covenant influences everything that we believe and do. So then, what is a covenant? Well, I define it as a gracious relationship that God enters into with his people by making promises, by giving signs, and calling for a faithful response. To get even more basic, covenant is the way that God chooses to relate to his people. Covenant is the way in which God forms a relationship with a people. When God wants to make a relationship with a particular people, he comes down to them, he gives promises to them, he gives signs to them that remind him and them of the covenant that he has made. very similar to how in a wedding ceremony, a husband and wife will give each other rings that is a permanent sign, a reminder. I've lost my wedding ring, so it's not so permanent, but it is a sign, it is a reminder that when the husband and wife see that sign, they are reminded of the promises that they have made to one another. So God comes to us and he works in a similar way. He gives us signs to the promises and the relationship that he has made with us. And what God calls then is he then calls the people to begin to walk. He calls on the people to begin to live in a new life together with him. That they don't continue to live walking in their old path, in their own ways, but that they begin to walk together with him. The idea, or the reality of covenant, rather, is rooted in God's own love. It is only God's love, it is only his desire to share that love, can only be the only reason that God would come down and form a covenant with us. God does not have any needs that we must meet. God has no lack that he wants us to fulfill. What God has is God has love that he can share with us, that he desires to share with us. And so God comes down and he forms this relationship with us so that we can share together in his love. And because of this, at the core, at the center of every covenant promise is the reality that God promises that I will be your God, that God will be God for us, and that we will be his people in his own possession. Last week we saw that after Adam fell into sin, God came down and God made one big, huge covenantal promise. That one day, he held that, one day one of your children, a seed of a woman, would come and will defeat the serpent, will win humanity back to God's side, back into friendship, back into relationship with God, bringing enmity between the man and the serpent. And since making that one huge covenantal promise, God then made consecutive covenants that developed in color in and detail that one single promise. And so God comes in covenant with Abraham and promises that his line is chosen to be God's people, that his children will live in the land that God has given them, that through Abraham, all the nations of the world will be blessed. God later comes in covenant with Moses, and the big thing that happens in God's covenant with Moses is that God more fully reveals his character, his righteousness, his holiness, and the call for the people to be holy as God is holy. And so Moses' covenant really does two things. It magnifies, it highlights God's holiness, God's righteous character, and at the same time, it magnifies and zeroes in on man's sinfulness, our failure to live up to that holiness. And so really, together, it magnifies our need for someone and something to come and take care of our sin. And in the covenant with Moses, God does cover over sin by animal sacrifice. There is an elaborate system of sacrifice to be carried out day in and day out, night and day, forever, in order to cover over the sin of the people. And later on, God covenant with David, and the key promise that God gives David is that one of his line would be established on an everlasting throne. And so put this all together, the Old Testament, the series of covenants that we see, is that God is going to win humanity back to his side, and he will do this by blessing the entire world, by dealing with the sins of his people, and by setting up an everlasting and righteous King. And what we find when we turn to the pages of the New Testament is that when Jesus comes, he comes in fulfillment of all of these covenant promises. When we begin to look at the very beginning of Jesus' life, even before Jesus' life, in the Christmas story in the book of Luke, we see this proof that Jesus comes in order for God to make good on all of his promises. The angel Gabriel tells Mary, he says, "Behold, you will conceive in your womb, and you will bear a son, and you will call his name Jesus. which means savior or deliverer. And Jesus will be great, and he will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end. Jesus dwells there, the father of John the Baptist. After John the Baptist was born, he breaks out in the song, and he says this in paraphrase. He says, I worship the Lord, for he has once again come, he has once again visited his people. He has raised up salvation for us in the house of David. God has come again in order to show the mercy that he formerly had promised to us. God has come once again because he remembered the covenant promises that he swore to Abraham. God has come again so that we might once more be his people, that we might serve him and live before him without fear. In other words, at the beginning of Jesus' life, we are reminded that in Jesus Christ, God is making good on all of the great and grand promises that he had made from Adam through David. And it is this fulfillment of all God's promises that we call the new covenant. And the difference between the old covenant and the new covenant is not that God has erased everything that he has done before Jesus, but rather the difference is the difference between expectation and fulfillment. The difference between a promise and the giving, making good on that promise. The difference between shadow and reality. Now, you might think the relationship between the old covenant and the new covenant as the difference between an engagement and a marriage. When a relationship begins, you begin to get to know one another, and if that progresses, then you agree that in the future you will get married someday. And this engagement is a time of preparation. It is a time of expectation. You begin to prepare for the wedding, the service, the food, the caterer, the location. Hopefully you prepare for marriage by counseling to get to know one another. And then the wedding day comes, and all of that preparation leads to fulfillment. The wedding, the marriage, does not erase the relationship that came before, but the marriage and the wedding is rather the fullest expression of everything that came before, the fullest flowering of the relationship. The expectation has become reality. Everything that was planned about, everything that was called for, everything that was hoped for has now come, and the couple is united together. And at the same time, the couple's relationship has been fundamentally transformed. No longer are they two individual lone persons that simply like and love one another, but they are now one flesh. They are bound together by the promises made, and there is now deeper unity, deeper union, deeper communion than what was known, than what was unknown before. And so this is a similar, you can think this is an analogy of the old covenant and the new covenant. The old covenant was a time of expectation, a time of hope, a time of looking forward to God making good of all the promises that he has made in Christ. And the new covenant is the fulfillment of that we see. But sometimes marriages do not live up to our expectations. We have an idea of marriage in our mind, and the reality does not fit the picture. And this is a similar situation to what the early church found herself in. Jesus had come, he had brought the new covenant, but this new covenant that they found themselves living in didn't meet all of their expectations. Jesus had come, he had said he was king of the universe, but yet what he left behind was a bunch of small groups of people that were meeting from house to house. The people in these churches weren't necessarily wise. They weren't wealthy. They weren't important. The churches would look around at themselves, look around at each other, and think this whole thing looks rather weak and pathetic. The church was pushed around by Jews on one side. They were pushed around by the Romans on one side. And so they began to think, maybe it's time to jump ship. Maybe it's time to go back to Judaism. You know, we look pretty weak and just meeting in our living room when there's a great, beautiful, golden temple that we can simply go back and begin worshiping in. A little meal of broken bread and wine really pales in significance to the great sacrificial feast that we see in Judaism, or that the people throughout the Roman Empire could have joined in their civic idolatrous feast. And so maybe, perhaps, this whole Jesus movement does not have the power, does not have the glory, isn't all that it's cracked up to be, and so maybe we should leave it and go find something else. And the book of Hebrews is written to address these people facing this temptation. And the basic book of Hebrews is that when you see the reality of Jesus Christ, what he has actually accomplished, when you understand by faith what you cannot see by sight, then you really begin to understand that Jesus in his new covenant is better than anything the world has to offer, that the new covenant is the real fulfillment of everything that has come before, that the new covenant, what Jesus brings, surpasses anything outside of him and that covenant. I read this morning some of Hebrews chapter 8. And what the author is doing in this chapter is contrasting Jesus' ministry with the ministry that Moses established. And this is what he says about the Old Covenant. He says that the priest in the Old Covenant serves only a copy and only a shadow of the heavenly things. So think about this. That if these people were Jewish believers, they could picture in their mind a great and glorious, humongous temple that had gold on the outside that was said you could not look at it when the sun was shining on it, because it was so bright and because it was so glorious. And the author of Hebrews is telling us that is a copy, that is a shadow of what Jesus Christ has done in reality. That is only a picture. That is only a, as I said a few weeks ago, a flannel graph board of the reality that Jesus Christ has done. Jesus Christ entered not into a building made by hand, but Jesus entered into God's house, into God's building, and in heaven, and it is from heaven, it is God's house that he ministers before his Father on our behalf. The author of Hebrews then quotes Jeremiah 31, which is about the expectation of the new covenant. When the people in Jeremiah's time were languishing because of their sin, when they were facing certain judgment because of their sin, Jeremiah prophesied that God is going to do a new work. He is going to still bring a new covenant that will deal with all of the promises, all the problems, rather, that the old covenant could not deal with. And the basic problem with the old covenant was this. It was actually powerless to deal with people's sin. It was powerless to change people's hearts. God says that he will bring a new relationship. He will bring a new covenant. And a new covenant will change the very heart of his people. He says in Jeremiah 31, which we have read and which is quoted in chapter 8 of Hebrews that I did not read, he says that he will write the law on the people's heart. The people will encourage one another to know God, to draw near to God, to be known by God. And then God promises, finally, to deal with their sins in a way in which he will remember them no more. Now, what's shocking in the book of Jeremiah is a few chapters earlier in Jeremiah 14, God is telling the people of Israel, he's saying, your sin is coming up before me, and I promise you, I will remember your sin. You will be judged because of your sin. But now in Jeremiah 31, and applied in Hebrews 8, God is telling them, I am going to do a new work. I am going to build a new covenant. I am going to form a new relationship with you. And at the central reality of that is that I will no longer remember your sin. And when we turn over to Hebrews chapter 10, we understand why and how God can make this promise. Because we are made holy through the sacrifice of Jesus. He says in Hebrews chapter 10 that Jesus' death was a once for all, totally complete sacrifice for sin. That Jesus' death, that Jesus' sacrifice was a sacrifice that would cover, a sacrifice that would take away all of God, all of the sin that all of God's people have ever committed. And therefore, he said, there is no more need for animal sacrifice. The animal sacrifices were only an imperfect sign that pointed to our great need. And because they were only signs that pointed to a great need, and because our need for forgiveness is so great, these animal sacrifices must happen day and night, continually, forever, until they were fulfilled in Jesus Christ. And so we said that there is no sin found among God's people that Christ has not died to forgive. That there is no sin found among God's people that God will any longer remember. That in Jesus, and that because of his sacrifice, there is complete forgiveness, and therefore no longer any need for another offering or sacrifice. And then in verse 12, Hebrews tells us that after Christ offered himself as a sacrifice, he then sat down at God's right hand, and there he is waiting for the moment in which all of his enemies are made into a footstool. And so in just our brief summary of two chapters of the book of Hebrews, we see that the new covenant, we have the fulfillment of a promise completed, for a promise of complete dealing with sin. We have a perfect sacrifice offered by a great and perfect high priest. We have a high king who sits down in his heavenly throne at his Father's right hand. And so really in Hebrews 8 and in Hebrews 10, we see the fulfillment made of the promises made to Abraham, made to Moses, and made to David. And these covenants, these promises are fulfilled in and through Jesus Christ. And in him, we can enter into this new covenant, this new relationship with God based on Christ and his work. But here's what the book of Hebrews says about, so that's what's different. Right, the new covenant is the fulfillment. It is the fulfillment of the promises made in the old covenant. But here's what the book of Hebrews says is similar between all of God's covenants. That covenant with God implies both relationship and responsibility. Covenant with God always implies relationship and responsibility. And so we heard already that the new covenant promise is the same, is in one sense, the same as the old. That God will be our God and we will be his king. This is the truth that is quoted in Hebrews 8. In the New Testament, if anything, the truth is amplified. The truth is highlighted because in the new covenant, God has become man for us. God has become man on our behalf. God has sent his spirit into us in the new covenant. Jesus is Emmanuel. Jesus is God with us. And it is this Jesus, this Emmanuel, this God with us that we belong to and that we are united with. And when we have been united to God in the person of Christ, we also have the spirit of God indwelling our heart. And so there cannot be a more intimate bond, a more close union between God's people and the Father. In fact, the Apostle Paul says that this union, that this communion, that this relationship is so close, is so wonderful, is so mysterious that the only thing it can even come close to comparing with is the marital love between a man and his wife. And so the idea of covenant always implies this relationship with God, which, if anything, in the new covenant is highlighted, amplified as we go nearer and nearer to God. But because we have been brought into relationship with God, along with that comes responsibility. And this is true of every single relationship. There is not a relationship that we have apart from responsibility. Think about spouses to one another. Think about parents and children. Think about friends. Each of those relationships comes with a responsibility that you must act out. Husbands must be faithful to their wives. Wives must love their husbands. Friends must be faithful and truthful to one another. Otherwise, the relationship disintegrates. And so it is also with our covenant relationship with God. And the same book of Hebrews that talked about the greatness of the new covenant is also filled with the sternest warning to us about forsaking that covenant. The difference between the new and old covenant is not that God judges his people in the old covenant, but he will never judge his people in the new. In fact, in Hebrews chapter 10, just after the author talked about Christ's perfect sacrifice for sin, and highlight how it is perfect, it is complete, it is finished, immediately after that, he goes on to warn about profaning the blood of Christ, about outraging the spirit of grace, and he says that the Lord will judge his people. And so you might be thinking, how is this good news? How is this gospel? How can the new covenant be any better if it still holds judgment over our heads? Well, because at the heart of the old covenant was God's law written on stone that simply said, do this and live. But at the heart of the new covenant is Jesus Christ, who says, come to me, all who are burdened and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. The warnings in Hebrews are all warnings about leaving this covenant. They are warnings about turning your back on Christ, about forsaking him, about turning your back and forsaking the relationship that God in Christ has formed with you. Jesus has died to pay for the sin of his people. Jesus has been raised to give you life to his people. Jesus lives in heaven to bring blessings upon his people. Jesus reigns as king in heaven to bring his kingdom over all the earth. In Christ we find forgiveness. In Christ we find blessing. In Christ we find his glorious kingdom. If that is true, then what do we find when we forsake Christ and turn away from him? Forgiveness that has blessing, that has commit mercy, we will only find condemnation. We will only find cursing. And we will only find a kingdom of darkness ruled by the evil one. And so really, the covenant warning of Hebrews seeks to tell us this. There is nothing good found outside of Jesus Christ. There is nothing good found outside of Jesus Christ. And there is everything good found inside of Jesus Christ. And so what is your covenant responsibility? How does God call you to respond to the covenant that he has made with you? You are called to set your eyes upon Jesus. You are called to trust in the work of Jesus. You are called to enter into the rest of Jesus. That you enter into his rest by trusting in all that Christ has accomplished on your behalf. You are called to look to Jesus when you sin. You are called to live out the new life that Jesus Christ gives you and to do it with joy and gratitude by showing the love of Christ to others. So God has brought you to himself and he has brought you into a covenant relationship that he has established in Jesus. God has given you his Son, he has given you his word, he has poured out his Spirit. And it is all of grace, and it is all by his love. But you are called to receive it. You are called to embrace it. You are called to step into it, to walk in it, to grow in it. That you are called not to neglect just a great salvation. To not neglect the salvation through unbelief, through bitterness, through skepticism. For these are the things that make us turn away from all that God has offered us in Jesus Christ. And so the new covenant that God has established obliges you, commands you to embrace all of Christ, to embrace Christ's work for your sin, to embrace Christ's lordship, and to walk in his love. It is really what the obligation that we have is really an obligation to receive the greatest privilege that human beings can imagine. To live as those belong to a loving Savior and a great God. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Heavenly Father, we would ask as your covenant people that we would walk, that we would live, that we would embrace all that Christ has done. Father, we would ask that you would give us the faith to receive these things. Father, that we would be a people who never neglect so great a salvation that we have in your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord.